أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم. We are discussing Surah 106, Surah Al-Quraysh, and we had covered two or three segments, and we had reached the stage where we today propose to discuss Rabba Hazal Bayt. Before that, we had discussed up to Liyabudu Rabba Hazal Bayt. But in order to recapitulate or to summarize what we had discussed, because some new friends may be joining also, in Surah Al-Quraysh, it is a surah of great wisdom. And I have always been saying that it needs to be prescribed for the foreign service academies, for defense services academies, and for strategic planners, and for other people who are involved with statecraft. But we have discussed the very few aspects of it. The surah deals with the historical fact that Quraysh, particularly four brothers led by Hashim, who conceived this idea, they formed a consortium, and then they concluded Pilaf Quraysh, and then they concluded more agreements with the tribes and with the kingdoms, with the empires, with the emperors, and that became Ilafihim. And they were able to conduct trade around all the ports on the Arabian Peninsula, on the Red Sea and on the Persian Gulf side, and in between, in the peninsula, and on the peninsula, they were operating around the year. Depending upon the wind directions, they moved in the east and the west and north and south, and they covered the entire peninsula. And then the another important aspect, which I had correlated with the history, is that what is the wisdom? What is the lesson in this that we can draw? That's very important. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us these ayat and surah, and it is for our benefit in this world. Whatever we have to do and whatever we have to act, we have to act in this world. The Quran is for this world, for us to act and understand. We find that there are similar historical facts also available, historical episodes or events available in the history, which we can, study in the light of these ayah. There is another important fact which I think I perhaps didn't mention, that after the advent of Islam, and when these ayat had come, for example, ayat number 282 of Surah Al-Baqarah, in which we had discussed that you have to document your economy and you have to document your transactions. The records from these ports in Egypt and in Tunis and many other places, which have been studied by the researchers, they find that the Muslims were documenting economy. They were documenting these trade transactions. And as I had said, that the documentation is required because it's then. And then is such a matter which can be taken to court. And there is an accountability for that. So there are even judgments which we find in Egypt and in Tunis also. So it's not only that it was being documented, that these documents are produced in the courts also in case of litigation in these trade matters. So it is in fact very important to understand Quran, these ayat, not only these ayat, but all the facts which are mentioned in Quran, we have to understand, correlate with science, history, and other facts. In this regard, I had also quoted in an example from Medici family, which became Medici dynasty, which ruled over Florence for 300 years. They produced four popes and they produce two queens. So this is possible. But what is the lesson? As I said, that today we are going to draw the lesson. The lesson is that you have to concentrate on your business. You have to involve your family. You have to train your children in the professions, in the business, in whatever the professions they choose or you choose. That is very important. And if you train your family and you set your objective, you set your mission, you set your vision, and then you link it with the greater good, as the Quraysh did, as they did it for the greater good of the peninsula, of the people, their tribe, and for the people all around there, then it gives better results. As Medici family, they linked their objective with the greater good, and they ruled over the world, very important part of the world. So this is the lesson, and we must give attention to our children, to our family, and to the objective which we have, and we must link that objective with the greater good, so that we start with ourselves, with our family, and we take it for the public good, for the betterment of humankind. Those who remain only self-centered, they don't progress. They may be opening the shop in the morning and closing the shop in the evening, that's all. But with this, with no resources, in fact, in the desert, they created a world empire of trade. Now, we had reached the stage Rabba Hazal Bayt, and it starts with this segment. It starts with Ya Budu Rabba Hazal Bayt. And in this case, I had given one example again from history, that in the 4th century, the church had compromised with polytheism, and they had even compromised on the design of the cross and the apostolic palace, that is the papal palace, was built on the design of the Greek cross, which has 4 equal arms. That was for the purpose of harmony. Very good. That they wanted to have the harmony with the Greek people, with the Greek philosophy. So that was an effort for creating harmony with the Greek people, with Greek power. They were in power at that time. They were also in power. But at the same time, this is 4th century. We find that in 325, in Nisan, a conference was held. A great international convention was held, where 5,000 participants had participated, and they decided for Trinity. 325, that is 4th century. And you remember that in the history of world religions, that century is soaked with blood. There was a lot of persecution who resisted this adoption of the dogma. They burned the books, they burned the people, they killed the people. On the one hand, there was no reconciliation, there was no dialogue, there was no possibility at that time for reconciliation. And on the other hand, with the polytheism, with the paganism, the harmony was taking place, and it was even being displayed. Now, what is the lesson for us? The lesson is, while we read this ayat, Ya Budu Rabba Hazal Bayt, there were 360 idols there. And yet they say Rabba Hazal Bayt. The Lord, He is not only Rabba Hazal Bayt or Rabba Hazal Balad, He is Rabbal Alameen. He is Lord of everything. And if you have to ask for anything, you ask Him, not anything else, anybody else. But they placed 360 idols there. Every tribe seeking, beseeching, praying his own Lord, own saint of his city, for example. On the one hand, they were ready to reconcile with the polytheism, because they allowed these idols to be placed there with the idea to have harmony among these tribes, and in order to protect their trade. On the one hand, this was taking place. that they wanted harmony. And for this harmony, they accommodated every idol, every tribe who wanted to place the idol there. Like as I gave an example from 4th century, and at the same time, and you have seen that their entire history, there particularly even at that time, it was soaked with blood. They were fighting among themselves. These tribes, as their tribal interests were clashing, they were fighting among themselves. Just look at the contradiction. Now, what is the lesson particularly for us today? We find that on one hand, our people, you find any sect, take any sect, Sunnis, Shias, Wahhabis, anybody, Barelvis, Devbandis, anybody, you take anyone, and all their leaders at international fora, at national fora, locally, even in their mosques, they talk of interfaith, they talk of multi-faith, they talk of reconciliation, and you will find them members on the polytheistic committees, on Sufi committees, on so many other interfaith committees, making very long speeches there on interfaith. But within intrafaith, no, we are not ready to talk to Sunni, they are kafirs. We are not ready to talk to Shia, they are kafirs. Look at the lesson from the history which this ayat is presenting, that on one side, they are ready to reconcile with everybody. So far as compromise on the religion or compromise on the monotheism is concerned. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had to send another surah. Kul ya ayyuhal kafirun la abud ma ta'budun lakum deenakum waliya deen. That they were ready to compromise on the with the paganism, but they were not ready to talk to each other as tribes, as you have seen in the 4th century and even what is happening today, that we are ready to talk on interfaith, but we are not ready to talk on intrafaith, which is dividing. So I think I leave it. This is a very huge subject, very vast subject, so I'm not going into further details, only just pointing out this part of the lesson, which is contradicting, which is pointing out our contradiction in this respect. I had mentioned some of these points, these slides, therefore I'm not repeating them, because today I want to conclude it, and I'll come to another important aspect that is very important. Now this last slide, they were ready to accommodate pantheism, panentheism, henotheism, this is what that surah. He carried henotheism, paganism, 4th century, you remember. In modern jargon, interfaith, multi-faith, but what about intrafaith? What about sectarian? What about ethnic? What about tribal conflicts? No, we are not ready to talk. Because in tribal, ethnic, in these both cases, asbiyat is involved. And in this sectarian, mostly our personal interests are involved. That's why we don't talk about intrafaith. We are not ready to reconcile. We are not ready to talk, not ready to accommodate. Now we come to the next segment and the last segment. That is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, atamahum, but word risk is not used. Risk is a much wider term. It includes all resources. But here only a specific limited aspect is in discuss, that they were provided tam, atamahum. Why? This is a question, a very important question of economy, economics. That I'll try to clarify, that why this has been used as atamahum and not as razakahum. You prepare different projects. There was a problem on the peninsula. There was hunger. Now, if you are given today the project to create an oasis on the Saharan desert, then people will immediately think about, they will collect data I'm preparing an economic development project, I'm preparing welfare project, I'm preparing poverty alleviation project. But here the problem was of immediate nature. Every day, three times a day, all the time, there was a problem of hunger. You remember the ayat of which is relates to the migration of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam to Mecca, and there he prays while raising the kawaid of Kaaba that I brought my family to a place which has no agricultural potential. Wadin ghair zi zarin. So if you start these projects there, if Hashim, they would have conceived of these projects at that time, they would have taken hundreds of years. They would have taken decades. And the trickle-down effect in the economics would have been very, very slow, extremely slow or negligible, not at all. But they prepared the project which immediately brought food for hunger. Even today in the 21st century, the Wadi remains Wadin ghair zi zarin, but you find the fruits coming from all over the world, samarat coming from all over the world. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the dua of Hazrat Ibrahim alayhi salam, then he accepted forever. You may not find the same fruit of the same quality in your country, but you find the fruits in the time of the best quality there. So they prepared a project which had no gestation period, and which had no time lag, which had no trickle-down effect. It had a direct effect to feed the people. And on continuous basis, the supply lines were maintained, were opened in such a way that on one side, international trade was taking place, and at the other side, the food was coming in, the supply was coming in. And that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said that don't stop the supply lines. وَيَمْنَعُونَ الْمَعُونَ. Don't hinder the highways, don't hinder the supply lines, don't disturb the peace, keep the supply lines open always. For meeting urgent challenge of hunger, this was the project, to meet the immediate urgent need. And here in another surah, in another ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using the word rizqaha. But there the word ta'am has been used. In this place, there is a different project. And that is a different project. We have to understand the difference between these two projects. That how these projects were conceived, how these projects were implemented by those people at that time, and then why this project which is before you now, on the Yemen side, why it ultimately faded, why ultimately it ended? Because they started fighting. They were not ready to reconcile. They were not ready to accommodate. They would accommodate God, monotheism, but they will not accommodate their asbiyat. Look at the difference. People will compromise on the belief of monotheism. Maybe they don't reconcile on they don't compromise even on ritual, but on the belief, but they don't reconcile on the asbiyat. In that situation, when it was definitely it was Wadin ghair zi zarin, and it was a desert. In that desert, a very technical term nowadays in 21st century we are using. In Wadin ghair zi zarin, and when there is no potential and it is desert, today in the 21st century in America, in Europe, we are using this term, food desert. Where there's, what is the food desert? And they've defined it. We read a word in the Quran, but we don't define it. We don't go deeper into it. We don't try to understand that what are the concepts involved. And those concepts are given if you go into the triliteral root. Those concepts are there. They have defined it as the area that has limited access to affordable and nutritional food. And they have further defined it that what is this desert? The U.S. Department of Agriculture report 2010. They have identified the people. They have counted the people. They have prepared the data. These things are there to invite our attention. They have provided the clues. They have provided the pointers. But we are not ready to listen to Quran in this manner. We are ready only to, I think I should not repeat it again and again, that we are not reading it for the purposes of understanding and for implementing Quran. It's wisdom. 23.5 million people were identified in US that they live in food desert. What is food desert? They have defined it. That is, they live more than 1 mile from a supermarket in urban areas and more than 10 miles from a supermarket in rural areas. Look at the attention which they are giving to the needs of the people and the welfare of the people. Hazrat Umar was so sensitive that if the situation of a food desert occurs along Nile, if there is drought, and even if the animal dies there, if a dog dies there, I am responsible for that. Are we looking after the welfare of the people, greater good? Are we conscious about it? Are we sensitive about it? Why these ayat are telling, inviting our attention to this storm? Atamahum min ju'in wa amanahum min khawf, in this situation of hunger. But we have never attempted to analyze it and prepare any data or historical data. And they have further linked it, low income groups. Naturally, there was low income. That's why there was poverty, there was hunger. And it was first time in 1973 that they started using this word, but Quran had invited attention 1500 years back. And then officially it came to be used in 95. Now, atamahum min ju'im wa amanahum min khawf. There are many political models. There are many political theories. There are many economic theories. And the economic interpretation, at least from Plato to Marx, the economic interpretation of history is analyzing these facts. When Pharaoh's Lulu was talking to Hazrat Umar that his master is not giving him the due share from what the value he is adding to the product as a technologist, as a metallurgist, he was talking about the theory of surplus value. And the theory of surplus value is the theory which changed the world in 20th century. Not only Russia, not only China, not only Far East, but East Europe. It changed the world around, changed thinking. These things are given there if we want to understand and we want to go there. The theory of Adam Smith, wealth. And these things are given there. But there are, in one word, there are clues. If you want to consider it further. Connection between hunger and food. This is the economic interpretation of history. And once the world was sensitized, particularly in 20th century, now all the economic planning in the world, in the advanced countries, is taking care of these factors and making planning basically on these factors. And then connection between security and threat to security. Atamahum min ju'im wa amanahum min khawf. Amanahum min khawf. Security and threat to security. That is why I say this surah should be prescribed in the course for the foreign affairs institutes, for the defense institutes, for defense strategic institutes, economic institutes. It has so many. But if there was time, if there was such a class, this is wonderful part of this surah. Atamahum min ju'im wa amanahum min khawf. But I don't think I'll be allowed to go into those details. The question of attack on Kaaba, was not new at the time of Abraham. Even before Christ, during 24 to 45, other empires, as a coalition force, even at the time as a coalition force, they had attacked. Actually, Kaaba was being attacked because they wanted the trade routes from the Arabs. Then Byzantine Empire, when it was established, the Byzantine Empire brought fleet into Red Sea in order to put end to the Arab trade. When Byzantines occupied Egypt and Syria, and they wanted to take over trade up to East Africa, India, and other parts of the world, but they were able to, Portuguese were able to eliminate the Arab trade in 16th century. The struggle was so long that we don't want to go into these historical facts and understand it. Religion has been used in history to spearhead geopolitical economic goals. That is what Abraha was doing. He was using religion. And he wanted to demolish Kaaba in order to capture trade. And it was not his personal design, he was just a governor. It was the design of the coalition empires at that time. And for that, they had started with a mission. A monk was sent earlier in 4th century. And then they started going further and further. And ultimately, when they saw that we are not able to divert to Sana'a, and these Ilaf are not, they were not able to break these Ilaf and bring the people there because they had accommodated them, their idols within the Kaaba, then they decided to demolish it so that they divert to Sana'a. This material is just available here. If there is any question, I'll go into these details, but I'm not on my own initiating it further. And with this, I conclude this surah with this lesson, again repeating that whenever there is a specific challenge, you prepare a specific project. For example, it was a project which required to address hunger and not the economic development. Here the hunger was placed first, and with that the economic development was brought in. It is a matter of planning. And then when you start your own individual business, if you work on principles as we studied in 282, you will prosper. And if you follow the rule, if you follow the law, if you are law abiding, then you will prosper. And if you want to prosper higher, at a higher level, involve your family, imratan, involve your imratan also, ladies also, your children also, train them. And when you train them, you then set your objective also and link it with the greater good. Here I may give you one example. You must have read that book, Discovery of Glimpses of World History by Jawaharlal Nehru. Glimpses of World History. We may not agree with him, what he has mentioned, what he has opined about the history. History is such a subject, people can have different opinions. You may not agree with the content. I also don't agree. I have thousands of observations, but why I'm mentioning it? If you invest your children in your children, that is why I'm referring to this book, Glimpses of World History. He was a politician, and before he became prime minister, before the independence was secured, he was sent to jail many times. About 9 times he was sent to jail. He used to teach Indira Gandhi himself every day as a tutor. He used to give her tuition. But when he was sent to jail, how to maintain that contact? How to teach the girl? So he writes in that letter that I am trying to prepare notes for Indra as I used to teach her, so that I keep sending these notes from here as long as the British allow me, till I am intercepted. If somebody went to see him, for example, then he would pass on those notes, that give these notes to my daughter. He wrote letters to Indira Gandhi on history, to teach her history, to teach the history at the level of the child. And those letters, when compiled, became a voluminous book of glimpses of world history, another book, Discovery of India. Now, at that time, there was no internet, no computer, a father sitting in jail. I am worried about the tuition, the teaching of his daughter. And he personally, from jail, tutored her daughter by sending letters in sequence, and they became the book which people today read as a book of knowledge. If you invest in your children, that's going to pay you. If you invest in your family, if you give attention to your family instead of sitting somewhere else, for example, I'm not against that, but I'm just saying, instead of sitting, for example, in a club, if we invest it in the children, in the family, and for a greater good, you can rule over the world from your small shop. You can become a tycoon. It's up to you. But this surah, I request, that needs to be read again and again in the perspective, its historical perspective. It's a great surah. It has linkage with surah 105 directly. And then it has linkage with Surah Al-Kafirun, and it has linkage with 282 ayat also of Surah Al-Baqarah, and it has linkages with many other aspects of Quranic and historical accounts. With this, I leave it to you. If there is any question, I would like to answer. If not, and if you want, we can start the next topic today or next time. I leave it to you.
بس maybe we can start next topic next time. اللهم صلي وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. اللهم اهدنا في من هديت وعافنا في من عافيت وتولنا في من توليت وبارك اللهم لنا فيما أعطيت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت فإنك يا ربنا تقضى بالتقضي بالحق ولا يقضى عليك. اللهم ادخلنا برحمتك في عبادك الصالحين. اللهم اخرجنا من ظلمات الجهل والوهم إلى نور العلم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يستمعون القول فيتبعون احسنه. اللهم اكفنا بحلالك عن حرامك وبطاعتك عن معصيتك وبفضلك عن من سواك. اللهم بفضلك ورحمتك على كلمه الحق والدين. اللهم انصر الاسلام وعز المسلمين يا اكرم الاكرمين. Oh Allah, spread your mercy upon us, shower us with your blessings, increase our knowledge, grant us forgiveness, and reward us with the company of the prophets and the Firdaus al-A'la. Oh Allah, beautify our heart, strengthen our faith, increase our knowledge, and make us benefit from what you have taught us. Oh Allah, forgive our parents, grant them your mercy, make their graves a garden from heaven, and grant them the Firdaus al-A'la. Oh Allah, we have friends and relatives who have passed away. Oh Allah, grant them your mercy and make their graves a garden from heaven. Oh Allah, remedy our sick and grant them full and speed recovery. Oh Allah, grant our son Ma'raj and all our sick relatives and friends a speedy and full recovery. O Allah, you alone is the ultimate curer. There is no cures but yours. O Allah, grant them a cure that leaves nothing of injury or ailment. O Allah, guide our children, protect them, and make them righteous. O Allah, we seek from you all of the good, whether we know it or we don't. We seek your refuge from all evil, whether we know it or we don't. O Allah, we ask you every name you have elected for yourself, that none of us leave this gathering, but his pains have been relieved, his worries have been removed, his debts have been paid, his weaknesses have been concealed, his sins have been forgiven, and his needs have been fulfilled. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adada khalqih wa rida nafsih wa zinat arshih wa midada kalimatih. Subhanallah wa bihamdih, adada khalqih wa rida nafsih wa zinat arshih wa midada kalimatih. سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على خير المرسلين اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه.